did. I hope you enjoyed David's show tonight. He worked his own special kind of magic, and it's always a delight to be here after David because we want to continue the magic. But tonight we want to continue stretching your imagination. We call the show Open Mind because we feel you need to have one here. And over the last over 5 years, we have spent a great deal of time and effort and energy to bring to you, for your perusal, if it were, some things that may cause you to open your mind. I have found in the past that everybody has a touch of reality. And I call it their reality box. A reality that is formed by their education, their belief systems, their living experiences, their religions. There are a lot of things that cause them to have a reality box. And that forms the reality box. And if you hear information that is outside of that reality box, you immediately decide that person's crazy, trying to put you on. He's lying to you, trying to deceive you, needs to be locked up. Or if it's the perception of your own senses that you yourself are hallucinating, or maybe you need a straitjacket. But what we have found here is that that's not necessarily the case. And this reality box, you see, forms a window, and it's that window that we look at reality through, and we have found that most people look at reality through not a window, but a peephole. And what we're about here tonight is to enlarge that peephole, if we may. And we have done that from time to time, and I want you to know that my peephole has hopefully become something more than that. I think it was about 3 or 4 months ago that we had an electrifying evening here, you and I. And I played some sounds for you, some tapes that were given to me by Mr. George Meek of a recording of a conversation. Are you ready for this? Between a person who is alive in physical life and a person who died in 1967, and the recordings were made in the early 80s. Well, we played those. I have great confidence in the gentleman who gave them to me. His name is George Meek, and the research that has gone on with his organization. He wouldn't have gotten on this show had I did not have that confidence. I had heard about him for a couple of years. Your reaction was electrifying, and I must confess to you that mine was too. And I am very, very happy to have in studio with me tonight, which I didn't have that night, George Meek. And we will have Dr. Mueller with us, who's been gone for a while, but indeed lives on. George, welcome to the Open Mind Show.
Thanks, Bill. It's a real pleasure to be here with your Open Mind audience.
Do you know what you did to us there? Yeah, you didn't know I was going to do that, really. You had given me the information. You had given me the cassettes. I worked with them, and I worked with it, and I just jumped in and put it on the air one night. I couldn't keep this from the audience out there. I want to tell you that the reaction to that night was incredible. I also want to tell the audience right now that I had a few of my facts not exactly correct. Nothing of any great preponderance. I was pretty much on time.
You did an amazingly accurate job, Bill.
But we'll get that squared away tonight. So what you're going to hear tonight, and I invite you to go ahead and turn on your tape recorders and call your friends, you are going to hear some live conversations, or recorded conversations, between a person who is alive and a person who is dead. And for the dead's the wrong word, right? On the other side. You'll hear some new material that George has brought with us tonight. I think you'll find it poignant and rather profound. You'll get a look at what life is like on the other side. So many people wonder about that, and I wonder about it. And George, I'm sure that you wonder about it too. We have a new perspective for it. So that's what you're in store for. Do you think we can keep them entertained for 2 hours here?
I think so.
All right. Let me do a couple of things because we have
Some interesting things going on at KABC before we get going. Now, if you're a KABC talk radio card holder, and we want everybody to have one of their talk radio cards, I want you to listen closely. Starting Monday, KABC has the big surprise package of terrific...
Let me assure you.
Let me assure you that you are. Before we go any further, could you give us a little bit of a background on your background and how you got interested in this field that we're in, which is, I think, enormously important.
Mm-hmm. Well, just by the way of background, I graduated from the University of Michigan in engineering, and I've spent most of the last 52 years in research and the creation of new industrial products. I built a reputation internationally, I might say, in this field. During one 18-year period, I made 44 trips to supervise a European research laboratory. Just prior to my 60th birthday, I made a series of inventions, and the royalties from these made it possible for me to stop off my profession and hopefully to spend the remainder of my life in self-financed worldwide research into the basic nature of man. In these studies, during the past 14 years, I have traveled the world over 5 times and many, many foreign trips. I've been fortunate in building up a network of 28 colleagues consisting of physicians, psychiatrists, scientists, and parapsychologists in 22 countries. These works that we have carried on in the areas of health, healing, and life after death have been published in English, German, Dutch, Portuguese, Japanese, and 4 native languages in India. I am currently serving as the founder and director of Life Beyond Death Research Foundation in Franklin, North Carolina. But so much for my background, and now I want to collaborate with Bill in presenting this detailed report of our work since 1971 on what started out as the electronic voice phenomenon but has progressed way beyond that more or less catchphrase, which was invented at that time as being a little less offensive than to confess that we were talking with the spooks.
Well, all right, we can go through all of that. We have done some shows here, and I remember the ones we had with Bart Ellis, where we displayed a number of examples of the electronic voice phenomenon, where you will turn on the tape recorder, you will ask whoever is there to speak, and every now and then you'll find somebody talking to you. You know, when you were there, you had your tape recorder turned on loud, you didn't hear anything, and whenever you play the recording back, you get a little burst of information. Yeah. Maybe a second or two or three.
I might break in and say that I had lunch with Bart Ellis today, and I want to pay tribute to him and to Attila Vanzali, Raymond Bayless, and Bill Welch, Californians, who all helped lay the foundation for what we've been working in the last few years. They did a great pioneering job right here in California.
They certainly did. And that was my first introduction, which was real early on in the Open Mind broadcast to that such a thing actually existed. But you took it a step further. Rather than having the little burst of information that happened catch as cash can, hopefully, you developed a process, or you and your colleagues developed a process where you could set up an electronic device of some kind that could be actuated by someone on the other side, which is a mind-boggling thing when you get to thinking about it. The information that is available to us in physical life that is on the other side is limitless if we only knew how to break those bonds. We have emotional and religious reasons for thinking that that line is so static that we can't get through it. We're beginning to find out that that's not true. It hasn't been true for a long time. There are people that have been having communication with the other side, I guess, since man's existence. The prophets had that. The mediums had that. I think the great inventors and the writers also were tapping into that knowledge that we're on the other side. But how could you say that in other than a belief system way or a mystical way, or it is my belief that this is so? Now we're getting it down to science. Something electronically is happening. which to me makes your work so very, very important, although it's very early and it's very embryonic in its technology. The what it portends is enormous, seems to me. How did that get started? Whatever gave you the idea?
I was inspired to get into this from the work that I said had been done here in California and similar work that had been done in Sweden by Friedrich Jurgensen. He had started getting so-called voices on his tape recorder back in the late 1950s. And I went into it far enough by 1970 when I started into this research full-time, as I indicated a few minutes ago. And I saw in 1970, at least to my conviction, that it was the start of an entirely new window on man's reality. And I opened a small laboratory in Philadelphia in 1971 where some of my electronic friends and I could start doing some more serious work, because we felt from the very beginning of our studies that a much more sophisticated approach was going to have to be taken to the development of the equipment. And we plugged along year after year. In the middle of the 70s, we were very fortunate in coming into contact with a new researcher, William O'Neill, who had the great ability of being so clairvoyant and so clairaudient that he could literally see and talk to the people that we wanted to communicate with instrumentally.
Now, let me stop you there for just a second, because it may be a little bit difficult for people who are listening to understand that there are people among us who have developed their senses to a point that they can discern things that are outside of the range that we ordinarily discern with our five senses. Now, in your case, William O'Neill could tell when someone was in his presence that was in the spirit world.
Yes.
Not only that, he could see them and hear them. We've had many of those people on the air.
Mm-hmm.
It does actually happen. And William O'Neill was one of those. The fact that you, as a listener, don't have that perception, and I must confess to you that I don't have it either, it nevertheless seems to very well go on. Okay.
Well, Bill, in the middle 70s, Bill saw and talked to a little gray-haired man that said that we should call him Doc Nick. Doc Nick had been a ham radio operator as a hobby away from his medical profession, and he wanted to work with Bill there in his laboratory, see if he could help Bill. And he made a suggestion that instead of the miscellaneous kinds of white noise that the EVP researchers were using, such as the noise between radio stations or the running water from a faucet or rain on a roof, that we should use some audio sounds as a part of the single sideband radio circuit that Bill was working with at that time. And as a result of that, we had the great thrill on October 27, 1977, of hearing Doc Nick's first words just barely coming through the quite loud mixture of tones which we had provided as a starting point. And when we play, Bill plays this tape for you in a moment, you, of course, will be hearing this tremendous static, background static, which is almost the same as I experienced some 60 years ago when I took a mother's oats box and wrapped a wire around it and made my first crystal set. But this was just the beginning, so you must remember that what has happened in the last few years actually had its inception in this very, very crude exchange of just a few sentences in October 1977.
But what we will be hearing, to my knowledge, and I think to yours too, George, is the first time it has been recorded an electronic conversation between a live person and a dead person. They're actually carrying on.
Yes, I agree with that.
I think that's probably a first in history.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's an important sound to hear. It will be a little bit difficult to maybe understand it, but you can understand it. And what you've done, you've set up tones, and those are now modulated from the other side.
That's right.
And to the point that you can understand them.
Yes.
Now, whenever you hear the voices of Dr. Nick here and Dr. Mueller, which we'll spend a great deal of time with, Dr. George Mueller, who died in 1967, I think it was,
right.
And these recordings were made in the 80s, he will sound like a robot. In fact, I think Bill O'Neill said, "You sound like a robot." Well, he sounds like a robot. But you can hear his consciousness, you can hear his inflections, you can hear his voice, and that's what's in front of you. I'm going to take a little break, and then, Bob, when we get back, we will go and listen to the very first recording in history, I think, of a conversation between a person who is alive and a person who is dead, the live person being Bill O'Neill, who is a technician that works with George, and the dead person is someone who identifies himself only as Doc Nick, George Meek, and we are talking about life on the other side and communicating with him on this side. And as we told you just before we got going, the first conversation, I guess the first recorded conversation in history between a live person and someone on the other side. Now, this is William O'Neill, who is a technician that works with you, George, and it's Doc Nick. That's how he, is that what you called him, or is that how he identified?
That's how he identified himself.
Okay. So, it's not going to be the greatest quality in the world, but you have to remember you're listening to a very, very historic piece of tape. So let's listen, shall we? I let that run a little long. I know it was long, hard to listen to. I know a lot of people are recording that tonight. But I wanted you to hear it because it was probably one of the most historic things that you can ever hear. Literally a recording of the first time that a living person talked with a dead person. I know that may be very hard for some of you to comprehend. But from all we can tell, that is exactly what happened there, George.
Shortly after that, we lost contact with Doc Nick. But it was our great good luck to have Bill make a clairvoyant contact with Dr. George Jeffries Mueller, who introduced himself and obliged by giving his Social Security number, telling us where we could go to a small town in California to find a copy of his death certificate. And he began what turned out to be a perfectly fabulous piece of research in combination with Bill. Initially, before we got up to the point where we had Dr. Mueller coming through on instrument, we had many, many months of two-way conversation between Mueller and O'Neill. And I was able to, during this phase, I got Bill to let a tape recorder run continuously so that it would take down anything that he said. And whenever Dr. Mueller would speak, then Bill would take time to repeat it. Dr. Mueller got a little irritated at all this lost motion, hearing what he said come back from Mueller. But it developed a tremendous amount of useful information, which a little bit later then enabled Dr. Mueller to further improve the system so that we could get his voice coming through via instrument, as you will hear later. But I want to share with you this interim step where Mueller and O'Neill conversed via this method that I just discussed.
I want to ask you a question. Could you set the scene for the audience of what that laboratory is like and what you had in motion there?
Well, I chuckle about it because when most of us think of laboratories today, we think of the large, shiny laboratories run by universities and by industry. And this laboratory hardly dignified the name. It was one small room in a farmhouse that had been built about 90 years previously on a very isolated road in the mountains of western Pennsylvania. But it was adequate for the very simple equipment that we were using in this early phase of our work.
Did you ever see Thomas Edison or Nikola Tesla's laboratory?
This was even more primitive than Thomas Edison's laboratory.
Well, a laboratory is where you're doing things on the outer reaches of man's imagination, really, and it could be anywhere. But you did have electronic equipment going.
We certainly did.
You were setting up electromagnetic tones. How did you arrive at those tones?
Well, we did not arrive at those until we got through this phase that I'm just describing now. It was after months of discussion between Bill and Dr. Mueller.
Who was dead.
Yes, who had died 15 years previously. Dr. Mueller drew on his lifelong hobby, which was the study of the theory of music. And he suggested a total of 13 audio tones, which spanned the adult male voice, going from 131 cycles a second to 701 cycles per second. And that information and a lot of other very helpful information was developed during this phase when the communication was only by the means which we will now have on this next excerpt of tape.
So what we're hearing are just tones that have been established electronically by you.
Yes.
You set up a microphone for the other ones to speak into, or...
Yes, I would like to describe that in detail, Bill, but from but that does not apply to this piece of tape that I would like to have him go right now. When he finishes this, I will describe for the listeners the actual equipment that then, from that point on, all the excerpts utilize in their production.
So this next tape is going to be with Dr. George Mueller.
Only the conversation between Mueller and O'Neill. We can't hear Mueller's voice. We merely hear O'Neill feeding back
what he said.
What he has said.
And then from then we find out how to hear Dr. Mueller himself.
That's right.
But we should establish...
But this went on for months, and I've got notebooks filled with very fascinating information. which Mueller brought through at this stage and which we built on for the next stage of our communication.
And from that way, from that information, you were able to actually build this, the Spiracom device.
That's right.
So it was designed on the other side, almost, in a way.
Right.
We should establish that Dr. Mueller, your research has shown, did exist. He was involved at the University of Wisconsin, as I recall.
He got his master's degree in physics from University of Wisconsin, his doctor's degree in physics from Cornell University, and then he held many jobs, important jobs, in the aerospace industry.
And as your research showed, he gave you unlisted telephone numbers, and you checked those out and find them to be unusually positive.
He gave us so much personal data on his own life that if we ever get around to writing it up, it'll probably be the best documented case of survival that is on the bookshelves anyplace.
Well, what I'm trying to establish here, you know, for the listener, is that all at once there was this entity affecting your electronic gear who identified himself as Dr. George Mueller. Dr. Mueller, as a result of your investigation, did exist. He gave you an enormous level of very personal information that wouldn't be found in books anywhere, and there's some really bizarre stories about some of the information that he gave you.
That's right.
Dr. Mueller really existed. And the character and nature of Dr. Mueller came out, as we will hear later in the Spiracom conversations, which were very much a part of his. He was a hard-nosed guy. In fact, as I recall, and we'll hear later, he said when he was on Earth, he was a jackass, in fact, which created some problems for him on the other side, which is very poignant about what happens whenever you're over there. So we will listen to this first conversation with, well, it's really a one-sided conversation, but Bill O'Neill is repeating what Dr. Mueller said.
Right.
We will hear Dr. Mueller a little bit later.
Right.
Let me take a pause so we can get to that, because I can't wait myself. You know, but this is one of the first conversations with Dr. George Mueller. We will not hear Dr. Mueller, as I understand from you, George. We will hear Bill O'Neill repeating what Dr. Mueller said. And this was a precursor to the Spiracom device.
Right.
All right, let's take a moment and listen to this. It's quite fascinating.
Dr. Mueller. Please, sir. Yes, sir. I'm looking. Yes, sir. I can see your lips moving. Well, you're pointing to your what? Your mouth. I don't... Yes, I can see. Yes, that's what I was saying. I can see your lips. Yeah, now it's getting better. Now it's getting better. Tell you that, when your voice starts to fade, Dr. Mueller, and I tell you that, do you do something, make an added effort make your voice audible again to me? No? You simply talk to me because you want to. You don't... Oh. You never thought about... What? How it comes about. Oh, you find it interesting, too. Oh. You would have found it interesting, too, were you in my place. Yes, I see what you mean now. Yes, sir. Well... Oh, yes, that... I agree. I don't know whether... No, here we go again. Why not call him George or Mr. Meek? No, I don't know whether that'd be satisfactory to my, okay, quote-unquote, book-writing friend or not. But, yes, it would be, it would be less. Yeah, here we go again. Time-consuming, You say there's no such thing as time, but, oh, golly. Excuse me for chuckling, Dr. Mueller, but you use the word time. Oh, I have it. I see. You say there's no such thing as time, but you continue to use the word force of habit. I see. All right, sir. Well, gee willikers, I don't know. I would say, Dr. Mueller. Oh, boy. Dr. Mueller. Oh, golly. Are you still here, Dr. Mueller? Oh, gosh.
Well, Bill was obviously a little bit flabbergasted about it, right? But for those who just came in with us, this is Bill O'Neill. He's a technician that works with George Meek, who is our guest here tonight on Open Mind. And Bill was having a conversation with Dr. George Mueller. We were not privy to it, and he was trying to repeat what he said. But I want you to hear, Dr. Mueller, and we will set up the tones again and let you hear. I guess this is the first recorded conversation with Dr. Mueller, who actually existed. The research of Dr. Mueller was real. He died in 1967, and in one of the excerpts, we find out he wasn't too happy with the way that happened. Was it unnecessary surgery or something? Or he thought it was.
Yeah.
In fact, as I recall, he looked most surgery is unnecessary.
Yeah.
But let's hear that conversation, because out of these kind of conversations with Bill O'Neill, you learn to develop the electronic process to actually communicate with someone on the other side. So, Bob, if you'll play that tape.
Yeah, you're just much better right there, will you?
Yes, sir, I understood, Doctor.
Very well.
Okay. Yes, sir. All right, Doctor. I'm sorry. I was lighting a cigarette. Yes, I did, Doctor.
Very well.
Very well, Doctor.
Now you can very definitely hear Dr. George Mueller. Yes, he sounds like a robot. But you have to remember that with the electronic apparatus that Bill O'Neill and George Meek and his group have set up, Dr. Mueller from the other side has to have an energy source in order to modulate those tones so that we can understand it in this much more dense level in which we live. Is that saying it in a way?
That's saying it very well, Bill.
When I hear those things, it runs chills up and down my back. You know, we deal with the fact that life goes on, that there is that the other side is really home, that we're out here on an excursion, but we now are looking at technology produce a window between life on the other side and this side, a window that here before had been reserved for the mediums, the real good mediums that were doing that, and the kind of mental direct communication that many people have received. In fact, I think everybody has from time to time of influences from the other side. But here's technology at work. What did you think whenever that first happened?
Well, it didn't come quite as much a surprise to us because we've been working at it for years. We knew this day would come. The only question was when.
Dr. Mueller told you so many, many, many things. I think, in fact, you said you could write a book about that. We're going to listen to some more of Dr. Mueller, but I think that we have spent 50 minutes here provoking the imagination of the audience, and I want them to have a chance to talk to you. We want to hear Dr. Mueller, and we will. Let me give you the numbers. If you're in Los Angeles, well, all the numbers, as you know, end in talk, T-A-L.
Sure, we take these calls. I think that our listeners might be interested in listening to another communicator on Spiritcom, a man who said that he had died 151 years earlier. That stretches the imagination even further, but I believe that that's the next tape that you've got laid out.
Yeah, I think that's number three, Bob. All right, let's take a listen to that, and then we'll get to our callers. Now, did he identify himself at all?
Yes, he said his name was Fred Engstrom. He said that he had lived in the rural area of Western Virginia, We were not able to, and it died in 1830. We were not able from the scanty birth records in those in that area to actually identifying the way we did Dr. Mueller. So we do not have that same degree of documentation that we had with respect to Dr. Mueller.
All right, but let's listen to Fred here. Again, another one. You're subject to anybody coming before your microphones, really, when you turn on the device, right?
Absolutely. It's what you call a drop-in communicator. And let me forestall a couple of calls here by pointing out that you may wonder why Fred Engstrom, who said he died in 1830, uses some modern terms such as robot and some slang phrases. We learned that Fred had been standing around in the laboratory for some weeks watching Dr. Mueller communicate with Bill, and he had picked up some of the terminology which they were using.
Well, I just got a note from Bob, the engineer there. We don't have time to play Fred. We'll get that back. Let's go to a caller and see what they're... I know that Ho, for instance, has been on the line for a while. Ho, welcome aboard. Are you there?
Here I am. Good evening.
Yeah.
Good evening, Dr. Meeks.
Good evening.
I got to tell you, I've waited months for this follow-up to the original show that Bill did, and that was really quite something. I've heard through the grapevine, and maybe you can confirm or deny this, that there have been some people that the open mind listeners may recognize have come through or at least been mentioned. One is Rosemary Brown. I've heard that Rosemary Brown was brought up at some point or another. Is that true?
Well, Rosemary Brown is still alive and well.
Oh, I realize that, but that somewhere down the line I had heard that Rosemary Brown's name or that the work she was doing was brought up by the spirits from the other side.
Not to my knowledge, sir. I know of no reference to Rosemary's work through our activities. I'm very familiar with Rosemary's work. She's done a marvelous job, but there's no cross-reference to here that I know of.
Ho, let me stop you for just a second, maybe do a little explaining, and maybe I can solve your problem. For those who don't know, Rosemary Brown is a psychic in London, in Wimbledon, actually, who is in contact with the great composers of the past, Liszt and Beethoven and the rest of them. And for a woman who has no musical training, she is producing the works of the masters, and she's just taking dictation from them. Now, there was a mention of Rosemary Brown by Dr. Peoples, who has been on the show before, and there may be the confusion.
All right. Has there been any reaction from either anyone in the government or from any of the religious people about the work that you're doing?
No, we have not had any contact by government authorities, and we have not sought any contact with the religious organizations. They have not, none of them have contacted us.
They probably wouldn't understand it anyway.
Perhaps not. I think it's fascinating. I live with a trance medium, and I know quite a few, and it's so marvelous to have something scientific that backs that up. Because so many people have said for years that, for example, mediums are simply split personalities and things like that, and this really proves that that's not the case. When Bill did the show originally, he talked about a video system that was hooked up as well, and there was an excerpt that he played where they were saying they were getting forms and no faces. Has that advanced at all in the last few months?
There's been no significant advance in the last few months. Actually, we have concentrated our work on the audio portion. We could see that the video problem was going to be even more complicated than the audio, and with our limited personnel and resources, we have decided to place our main effort on the audio communication.
It's called taking baby steps, Hub.
I understand. Believe me, I do. All right, it's marvelous work. Keep it up, and thank you both. And Bill, keep up the good work.
Well, thank you very much. It's easy for me to keep up the good work when I have people around like George Meek who are keeping up the work and so many, many others. And I don't believe that this first hour has gone on by. We have so many more things for you to listen to, and we want to answer as many of your questions as we possibly can. And I'm so delighted that George Meek flew in to be with you and I tonight and to talk about Spiritcom and let you listen to these incredible, incredible recordings. We'll be back after the news tonight. And, you know, I'm very fortunate. I get to come to work and do this, and they pay me to do it. And I love every single moment of it. It's the high point of my week. And to be able to share with you the things that come across my desk every day is a delightful thing to me. With me is George Meek of the what do we call that? The Life After Life Foundation?
Life Beyond Death.
Life
Research
Beyond Death.
Research Foundation.
Something that, of course, we talked about here for the last 5 years, that it does exist, it goes on, and because of George's research, we now have technological proof of it. If you weren't with us the last hour, we listened to some amazing conversations, some historical recordings of William O'Neill, who was a technician in your organization, talking with two different people, Dr. Nick and George Mueller. George died in 1967. Dr. Nick died back in the 1800s sometime. But we have a recording of a live conversation going on. And I have another surprise for you. And he's on the telephone right now. And, George, I know you don't mind.
No.
Let's take some moment to talk to Dr. Frank Baranowski. And I'm so glad that Frank is in town, because Frank, from another aspect of this matter of continuing life, life on the other side, has been deeply involved in it. His research, I think, is profound and probably is the avant-garde look at hypnotic regression, moving people into other lives. Now, where you're talking to people who have gone over to the other side and are residing there and now using technology or conversing with us, Frank's technique is to bring out these past lives that have gone on, and he has some amazing stories. Frank, are you there? Hello? I did press K. Frank?
Yes.
There you are.
You sound great. It's a terrific program this evening.
Well, thank you very much. Say hello to George Meek.
Mr. Meek, sir, I'm deeply interested in your research.
Well, I've just learned about yours for the first time tonight, and Bill has promised to help me get up to date on the fascinating things that you've been doing. It seems to fit right into our work.
Oh, so many. I had the pleasure of staying 3 days with Rosemary Brown way back in 1973. You mentioned briefly some of the work that's coming through her. And in one of those days, I watched her work on about 17 different manuscripts in the course of 2 hours, adding a few notes here, a few bars here, when you could feel the coldness, the heat or the warmth of the room would change when she'd say, Chopin is now here, and he, by the way, he greets you as a countryman. I happen to be Polish. Franz Liszt would...
One would never know with a name like Baranowski, right?
Well, I tell everybody it's Irish, Bill. Because when I tell about my lucky Polish leprechauns, nobody's ever heard of them, you know. So. Anyway...
Do you know what she did for me?
Rosemary Brown?
Yes.
No.
The movie we're producing?
Yes.
Heirs of the Gods?
Yes.
We have a sweeping, new, brand new theme, originally for Heirs of the Gods, written by Sergio Rachmaninoff.
Oh, boy. Well, the lady is as honest as they come, believe me.
Yeah.
And when she is saying that she sees these people, she's communicating with them, she really is. Bill, have you heard of another amazing woman named Professor Marilyn Rosner from Montreal?
No, other than a brief conversation we had this afternoon, I had not heard of her.
I've heard of her.
Marilyn is a professor at Vanier College. And she works with close to 500 physicians. She helps them with their patients. She'll look at them, and she says she is able to communicate with, quote, unquote, spirit guides, and they will tell the subject what they are lacking of calcium, so on and so forth. She has completely amazed so many of these medical people that they work with her rather than against her. Her husband is a full-fledged Anglican priest, and she has stunned the canons of that church with her accuracy in describing canons who have passed on, who have served various posts throughout Canada, and names, information, and she'll say, well, they're standing right here. Don't you see them? They made a film on this young lady 2 years ago, the Canadian Broadcasting, and perhaps it's the most highly played documentary in the provinces. She has her own television program called Beyond Reason, her own radio program, and now her own columns are appearing in a few of the Canadian newspapers. She is, wow, startling.
Well, we'll try to get her on this fall.
Okay. You may have some difficulty because I think she...
I have difficulty getting people on this fall. You know, I have to rearrange to do that.
Bill, she, I think, told me on the conversation she's going to be home in Montreal 17 days this year.
I can imagine.
Yeah, she travels around a lot. She just came back from India helping with Mother Teresa. She has been accredited by the government of Spain because of her fantastic ability to come in and tell people what they're lacking in their educational systems. By the way, she's a behavioral therapist and an educator. Her degrees are, well, many. I think she graduated from high school at age 11, a regular child prodigy, who was teaching at universities at 16.
Well, Frank, you know, you deal with what we call this window between physical life and spiritual life.
Yes.
And from what you've heard tonight of George's work, where does that stack up in your mind?
Well, it gives you a moment for pause here. Let me say that this type of work is very difficult to understand. We look at the entire field, Bill, as, say, for instance, the psychic down the street. How accurate is the psychic down the street? And you and I know there are more psychos running around than there are psychics.
That's well put.
Well put.
And if you can gather this information to a degree of credibility, you can go up to the next step. We've been talking about the possibility that you may or may not have lived before other lives. And then suddenly now we're trying to prove that there are voices from beyond the grave, voices that are there from entities that have not, what, decided to reincarnate, didn't have to. And here they are coming into what we consider a new form, a new channel.
Our world.
But it isn't new. Edison, in his writings, in fact, instructed his wife that there was a special closet he did not want destroyed after his death because he believed that those who had passed on would remain close to those that they loved and wanted to be with and would communicate with them. Now,
Tesla also communicated with them, and he credits his great inventions from friends on the other side.
Oh, gosh, heaven's sakes, yes. So